Now we're going to move on and hear from some practitioners about how they use formative assessment during their projects. And just by way of introduction, when we say formative assessment, we're talking about assessment that happens during instruction to help learners see where they stand with relation to the learning outcomes. So this is in contrast with summative assessment, which is performed as a concluding or a summing up kind of assessment at the end of a stage of instruction, for example, the public product. All right, so in formative assessment, there are so many different ways that you can do it. We have traditional ways like paper and pencil quizzes, but it really helps to expand your thinking beyond this. You can perform assessment simply by observing how a classroom activity is carried out. So you can have a round robin kind of task where the teacher takes part in the task just as if the teacher were one of the participating students, but the teacher makes note of student performance during the task. You can have integrated performance assessments, which are a series of events beginning with an input, which could be a video or a reading, progressing through a negotiation or interpersonal stage, and ending with a presentational stage. You can have simple checklists as whether things are done or not done, or checking on the level of knowledge. I know this or I don't know this. That is a formative assessment. It's like taking stock of where you are and where you need to go. Other possible methods include reflective journaling. You can have peer assessment. In other words, learners are assessing one another's skills, knowledge, and dispositions, but this should be low stakes, right? You shouldn't ever have a student determining another student's grade. All right. Here are some examples. Now, these might be presented in English, or they might be presented in a target language. It depends. At the beginning level, it's always a question whether how much English you should use, because students may not be able to handle the target language enough to do sophisticated prompts. Let's look at these individual reflection style formative assessments. If students are assessing themselves on how well they did when they were trying to put survey results into a summary, they can simply say how hard it was for them. They're reflecting on their own learner. Or down at the bottom, maybe they got more than they expected. That would be a very good outcome. Or everything just went by in a blur and they couldn't follow anything. So these are rubrics for students to circle the statement that best matches what they feel like. You can also have reflection on group processes. You will note that Yao was talking about assessing group work, how well students collaborate with one another. So you can have items like these. All right, you can have language-specific, language skills type assessments. So for those, you can ask students, this is particularly good for beginning learners, just have them circle the things that they do recognize, the things that they're pretty sure that they do understand. Or you can have a very traditional style item, like the second item, which is a translation problem. So there's only one of those Chinese choices that is grammatically correct. All right, so having offered you just a few of those items to consider, I would like to invite our panelists to step in. First off, I would like to invite Adam Ross, who we have heard from before. Adam teaches at the Chinese American International School in San Francisco. Adam?
Hi there, can you hear me?
Yes, your sound is very good.
Oh, good. Okay, I'm sharing my screen and I have a brief presentation for you. Oops, I'm sort of hitting the wrong button. I need to present, not share. Okay, does everyone see my screen?
Yes,
visibility. Okay. Good. Terrific. Okay, so I'm going to be talking about how I have been implementing formative assessment, particularly using online tools in a PBL interview unit project that I've developed. And just to give you a quick introduction to what this is, since I talked about Project Squares last week, I thought I'd share a Project Square that I developed for this project 3 years ago. And the idea, very briefly, and you can just read through this on your own, but very briefly, we're asking our students to find a recent Chinese immigrant to California. I'm talking to you from San Francisco, California, to learn about their experiences here, their difficulties, things they like about the U.S., their perspectives on the U.S., all sorts of different questions. And then my original idea was to create a web page having to do with this Chinese American life. And over time, it's developed into People of Beijing or People of China, and different. There's been different titles for this project each year. And the purpose is for our middle school students and also high school students that I teach in an online class to learn about Chinese immigration, both in terms of activities that we do to scaffold the experience and then directly from actual Chinese immigrants. The product that students create is to create an actual video introduction, a little mini documentary about their subject, which they narrate over. And then the original audience was just simply for students in our community, but we have a different audience this year, which I'll share with you in a moment. And so just hold that thought. I want to share with you, not everything is showing. Oh, here we go. I had it in that way. We use a number of online tools to facilitate the interviews this year. On the left-hand side, you'll see that I mentioned Skype and Snagit. Skype, I think most people are familiar with, to do online chats and discussions. Snagit is a tool that you can add that will actually record both sides of an online conversation, so that when you're recording, you can record your own voice from the mic, and it'll pick up the person you're speaking with online. And then students will use a tool like iMovie to actually edit the footage of their video into their final product. But on the right-hand side is mostly what I want to talk about, that these are three tools available online, both available in free versions as well as paid versions in the case of Flipgrid, that can support formative assessment in the project. So these are Padlet, Google Forms, which probably most of you are familiar with, and then Flipgrid, which is a very powerful tool. And I'll give you little demos of that as well. So I'm going to skip right out of my presentation and share with you other screens in my browser, and I want to make sure that you can see this. Is everyone's Stephen? Can you tell me if you can see the Pebbles page from?
Yes, it's visible.
Oh, great, thank you. So I'm sure you may or may not have been shared this page from the NFLRC staff, but for those of us who have taken part in the summer workshop, we have published our units. And so the one I'm talking about, if you want to learn further, is down here with the CASE logo, the Chinese American International School, where I work. And you can go in and click on this at any point and read more about it. I'm clicking on it now, and it's hopefully coming up. There it is. And you can read about this project in more detail. However, this year, our project is a little different because we have a different challenge. There is an organization that's actually located here in San Francisco called the 1990 Institute that runs a yearly video contest for students all across the U.S. to submit videos on some subjects about China or Chinese people. Most of the video submissions are in English, but they have a contest for Mandarin speakers, and that's what we're doing. We're actually following the rubrics of the contest to interview a Chinese person, and I'll make a little plug. I talked to them and said, maybe you should do a project like we've been doing, and they're doing that. It's ongoing right now, and our students need to finish by the end of the month. You'll see here February 28th is when it's due, and it's again to interview a recent Chinese immigrant. And so they have all sorts of information here and ideas that they can do, and they actually have rules as well. I'm going to scroll all the way down to show you that they have a number of questions that must be asked. So this was our starting point for this year's project, to get students to come up with ways that they can And they can think of these questions in Chinese. So what I did with my online students, let me get my right page. I'm gonna go to my Padlet page. Here it is here, where I actually raised these questions with our students. They found translations for these four questions. And then the next step was to come up with additional questions, follow-up questions based on their own ideas. So this is all in Chinese, but what I've done is I've created a column for each student. So here's one student whose Chinese name is Hu Geran. Here's another student whose name is He Songping. And they're sharing with each other live time in our online class the questions they want to ask. And they've listed things down. And in terms of formative assessment, you may see here in the second column that I've highlighted some characters. And this is where I'm suggesting that maybe the way they've written doesn't quite make sense. So He Songping, for his second question, he wrote, 你下一次去美国会做什么? Which is saying literally is, next time you go to the U.S., what might you do? And I said, well, Songping, they're already here in the U.S. and we're here in the U.S. So going to the U.S. doesn't quite make sense. You probably have to change this into 来美国 or coming to the U.S. And then I've done this for other sentences as well, highlighted text and talked with them live while they're writing so that everyone can hear this sort of feedback as they're working. And then by using Padlet, students have come up with their own questions and then they can see what other students have to ask. They can borrow these questions, they can offer comments if they think it's a good question and so on. And this was actually an actual 20-30 minute long activity that we did together. Another activity that we did with our middle school students engaging in the same project is to use Google Forms. So again, we created a page here, just simply says interview. We ask students to select what section they're in. We give them a little template about how to introduce themselves. So this very first sentence is, 我是中美国籍学校的学生, 我叫 blank, blank, blank. 谢谢你接受我们的访问. So I am a student at CASE, the Chinese American International School. My name is, and they say their name. Thank you for willing to be interviewed by us. And then we've taken the four must answer questions that they've already translated, and then ask them to think, what are some possible follow-up questions? This could be follow-up question A or follow-up question B, and write in your version of a question here, and then do the same thing for the question two and so on. And so the students did this a couple weeks ago at the start of the month. We can look at all of their answers here. Let me do the summary responses. There's all of our students, there's our answers, and here are all of their answers together. But typically, this is something that's only shared with the teacher. So we have to go in and look at these together. We can actually download an entire spreadsheet of all of their questions and then highlight individual responses and copy paste things that they might want to change for them. But this is one way for the students to actually brainstorm and ensure that they've done this level of thinking of question and answer together with us. And then the third tool I want to show is Flipgrid. And so this is something literally I just published yesterday for our students. And so I've created a little video page here. You won't be able to hear it, but if I click it, the students will open it up. And they'll hear me saying in Chinese, you've come up with an outline of what your interview would be like. Think about how you might want to do a voiceover. And so a voiceover of what the contest would be. So each student just wrote out something they might say and shared it last night with each other, and then they publish this. And the nice thing about Flipgrid is that this first student, Fang Xule, published her answer, and then anyone who comes in later can go listen to see what she had to say. So if a student is stuck and doesn't know what to say, they can go in and hear what their classmates are doing. It's something that's truly formative. I don't know what to do. What has Fang Xule said? Oh, so maybe she's giving me some ideas about how I could phrase what I have to phrase. It's just simply some practice for learning how to say what you want to do in your voiceover for your video. And then just finally, this is just to show the summative project. This is just the start of a video that a student did last year in Beijing, where we did a a similar interview where she's in a homestay interviewing her homestay mom over dinner, and she has a narration over it. She explains that she comes from Inner Mongolia originally, and then it goes on to say that she eventually moved to Beijing and so on, and then gives her story within a 2 or 3 minute video. So I want to make sure I'm not going over time. So I will stop here and share my coordinates with you, and then check with Stephen if he has any questions for me based on what was in the chat.
Hello, everyone. My name is Zhang Jie, or you can call me Jie Zhang. And I would like to thank Stephen again for inviting me to be part of this year's Institute. I actually am very new to the to PBLL, and I was a participant of last year, and I attended the Summer Institute. So this is the very first PBLL project that I did with my students. And I would like to say that this is a really initial attempt of doing it, and there is lots of space to improve it. I just want to share with all of you, and we'll see. Yeah, oh, I want to say that I'm still a project in progress. So the project is called the Study Abroad in China. Are you ready? Okay, so I did this project with my student. Well, I teach in the Chinese program at the University of Oklahoma. So I did this project last fall with my fourth semester Chinese listening and speaking classes. We had 12 students in the class, and the course covers topics related to students' daily life, mostly campus life, at the active or intermediate low to intermediate level. And many of the students will be studying abroad very soon after taking the second year course. So they really have lots of questions about study abroad, lots of questions about life in China, and they wanna explore how it would be. So they'll be more prepared. So in the first half of the semester, I asked the students to interview a Chinese college student about their life in China. So they did that using Flipgrid. And they had a good time, and they learned a little. We read about college life in China, and they interviewed. So they had some idea about what college life is or is different from their life here. And then I did this PBLL project in the second half of the semester, and it ran 5 weeks. So this is my project square. So the driving question is how to help students in the Chinese program at my university to better adjust to their life when they study abroad in China. And I would like to think that there is a real audience that this project serves, because many of the students in that class will study abroad very soon. And also there are other students in the program who will appreciate this knowledge as to how they will do or how they expect when they study abroad. And the community partners mostly are students in our program who have recently studied abroad. And the products, I'm asking my students to develop a Google website that they can share with the class and also with all the students in the program. So my students, I discussed this with students, and they feel like they will use this information when they go study abroad, and also it will help other students. So they were quite motivated when working on this project. So here is a brief list of tasks that we went through. First, I asked them to decide as a group which aspect of a study abroad your group would work on. So they eventually ended up in three groups of four, and each group chose a different topic. One group chose a pre-departure preparation, and the second group chose food and diet in China, And the third group choose things you can do while in China. So I asked them, and we did this in class, writing interview questions. And I asked them to, you know, keep writing their interview questions after class. And then we had a report, in one of the classes. And then we discussed their questions and all that. And they submitted their revised questions a few days later. And here, I actually want to mention that I also got very inspired by what Adam just said. I think in here, the palette would be a very good thing to use to do this, working on the interview questions. And the second task, I ask students to contact their interviewees and interview at least the two people who just studied abroad. And then they reported their results in class, and we went over questions like what you found out, what other questions you want to ask, and what, what are the results would contribute to your, your final product. And I didn't do a written, I didn't ask them to do a written report at this point, but probably in the future, if I want to do this project again, I would ask them to do a written report, that each group would write a report. And then the third task is the group research on information about foreigners study abroad, just online, and to further expand their knowledge about their topic, and then, to put things together at that point. And then they did a brief report in class and talk about what they have found out at that point. And also in the future, they probably can do a written report together with that. And then task four will be to design their group webpage and then submit to me for proofreading and editing. And then we launched the project on November 15th. They presented their group webpage in class, and I invited other students in the program to attend, but it looks like everybody was busy back then, right before Thanksgiving, so nobody really went. But we did share the URL of the website, our Facebook page, and through our mailing list. So, and we got very good feedback online. And then lastly, I asked the students to submit a team distribution form detailing who did what for each specific task. So this is the project, the product that students did. And I did not really ask them to do a bilingual site because I was conceptualizing it more as a project using Chinese, but students voluntarily choose to do it as a bilingual site. So this is the site, and this is the homepage. As you can see, the homepage is, I would think, the most poorly made because I made it. And all my students did a whole lot better job than me. So you can see there are three tabs that each group did their own individual page, and then they decided to do a separate Google page, that can be linked to this homepage. So if you click on it, you can see this is what they actually did. So this one is about food and diet, and they incorporated their interview results, their interview findings, and also their online research findings. And they had both Chinese and English. This is one page. The other page, let me go back. This is for things to do in China. So you can, for this group, they also have their own homepage, and then they have a separate tabs that as to what you can do in Shanghai, in Beijing, and also what you need to prepare before you go out actually in China. So you can take a look. These are the fun things. And this particular Shanghai page is made by a student who is currently studying abroad in Shanghai. So this is really a cool thing for her to do because she is using this information right after she did this project. and in Beijing, and also what you would need to do about the subway and, you know, ATM, and where, you know, if you get lost, how you find your you know, hotel or like dorm, and WeChat and all that. And the last page is right here. The last page will be the pre-departure preparation. So you can see the included scholarship information, visa information. So they introduce where you can get your visa, and then where you can buy your tickets, and a checklist for your luggage, like medicine or currency and clothing. And apps that you need to, cell phone apps that are useful while in China. So yeah, this is the final product. Okay. So a little bit of reflection. As I said, this is the first time I did a PBLL project, and I can tell that the students really loved it. They were very motivated in working on their projects because they got to choose what they wanted to work on, and they got to decide who they wanted to interview. And they were very motivated from the beginning to the end, and the end result is very impressive. And I can tell it's clearly the result of a collaborative effort, because no individual student can do that well. But on the other hand, I also feel that the assessment of individual students is challenging, because everybody participated, and usually in each group there is a language expert. It seems like the language expert does the most writing or editing work, so I'm not very sure how to engage everybody in, you know, making progress in terms of language or in terms of other aspects, for example, group project management or other 21st century skills. So I think as a group project, the challenge might be how to assess individual students. So that's just my little take. But as Stefan just mentioned, I would think doing self-assessment and peer assessment will be very useful tools in my future implementation. Those might be able to address what I just discussed. And lastly is a team composition that I used with my students. I would ask them, for each team, they need to have a Chinese expert, a technology expert, a content expert, and a interview expert. So it's something that helps them to form an effective group that everybody can, you know, can use their strength and contribute. So yeah, that's a brief introduction of my project, and I really look forward to do this or similar projects again. And I'm sure there are lots of things that I can improve. Thank you.
Thank you, Jie. That was very interesting. We do have a couple of